ある惑星から地上の生物を食料にしている深海怪獣ジグラが地球征服にやってきた。
地球のこの美しい海は私のように美しい姿の生物が支配すべきである。
しかし人類の味方である正義の怪獣ガメラはこれを迎え撃つ。
地球人類に次ぐ速やかに降伏せよ。物質破壊、四次元殺人光線発射。
助けに来るのを待つだけだ。それよりトム、酸素は？
あと15分しかない。
ではでは、あの4人を見殺しにするっておっしゃるんですか？
助けてパパ。
よし、こっちで。
パパ、ヘレン、パパ、ヘレン。
4次元光線体火炎噴射、オレンジ光線体回転ジェット、ダイエーが送る年に一度の怪獣映画の決定版。ガメラ対ジグラにご期待ください。
Hey everybody, this is Michael again, and welcome back to my channel here on YouTube. Well guys, continuing to give my thoughts on all the original Japanese versions of the Gamera films. And today's film, as you know already, is Gamera versus Zigra. And this, of course, is my Shout Factory release of the film, guys. And some of you have written in and asked me if I'm going to discuss the Blu-ray releases put out by Mill Creek. Well, at the end of these reviews, I will give a little bit of my thoughts on those releases. And some of the other releases that I showed earlier in my collection of Gamera films, so rest assured you will hear my thoughts on those films. This also contains Gamera the Super Monster, guys. There's the disc itself. And here's the back. There you go. And opening it up, guys, we have the same background shot of the innards of Gamera, plus this. Okay, guys. First off, what I'll say is that this is like the other releases with two films on the same disc, and there's no commentary on the film itself. There is a photo gallery, and pretty much that's basically all you get other than the photo gallery and an American dubbed version of the films. And one thing I noticed immediately about Gamera vs. Zigra is that the picture quality is decent, but at the same time it looks like they actually went like it's a lower resolution and they just blew it up, because that's how it looks. If you ever watch the video on YouTube or some other internet site, and when you blow that picture, if it's recorded at a low resolution and you blow it up and it just kind of looks a little bit distorted, that's how Gamera vs. Zigra looks. It looks like the master for this film was created or done at a much less lower video quality than what's on the DVD. The other films look pretty good, but this film looks like it's been just blew up to the point that it's just it kind of screws up the video quality. And if you've got this film, you'll know what I'm talking about. And I even did a little research online, guys, and went back and seen if other people had this same problem. And apparently, it is something that is on every disc. Now, I don't know if Shout Factory just made a mistake. The video quality is definitely nowhere near on the level of the films that have been released previously. And the same for Gamera the Super Monster, which I've already watched, guys. The video quality on it is not nearly as prevalent as the one on Gamera vs. Zigra, but it is still there. So the final films in the series are not only a letdown in quality as far as the series goes, but the video quality on the DVDs themselves are not really that great. Now, one thing about Gamera vs. Zigra that I'll say, guys, is that the overall story itself is, or at least it starts out as a commentary on pollution, ecology, and all that kind of stuff. And what's kind of funny in a way is that at this time Toho had done Godzilla vs. Hedorah, and in that film we have a definitely pollution message, a story on ecology, the story on taking care of the environment and all that. So where I have this film, Gamera vs. Zigra, which also contains elements about the environment and all that, Godzilla vs. Hedorah was really kind of heavy-handed on it. Not that that's a bad thing. I enjoyed the pollution aspect of the story and how we need to save the planet. But in Gamera vs. Zigra, they touch on those things, and it's like at the beginning of the film, they discuss it. And then by just a little bit into the film, it kind of just goes away. You don't hear any more about the ecology story anymore, which is kind of strange considering that's how they started the film, but then they just dropped it. Toho did a much better job, not only as far as Godzilla vs. Hedorah, which is a underdog of a film, guys. The film has gotten a lot of bad press over the years, but I think it's probably coming to its own now, and a lot of people really enjoy that film. I know that I did. Where Godzilla vs. Hedorah handled the ecology, the environment, taking care of the planet, save the planet storyline very, very well, Gamera vs. Zigra started it and then just simply dropped it. So it's kind of like an afterthought in this film, and you got to wonder why they even decided to go that route if they weren't going to use it in the entire story. Now, I will say, guys, where the last film I talked about had a whole lot to do with the Japanese Expo, and as a matter of fact, it kind of almost seemed like the film was just a running commercial in support of the Expo. We have this film, Gamera vs. Zigra, and we have SeaWorld, which is very, very prevalent in the film. You hear a lot of selling points to SeaWorld. This film is almost a running commercial for SeaWorld. So I think, and rumor has it, that SeaWorld sponsored this film pretty heavily, gave it a lot of support financially. So that's one of the reasons why SeaWorld is such a big selling point in this film. And that a lot of the action, a lot of the actual location shooting was filmed at SeaWorld in this film. Now, I believe that a lot of this was also due to the fact that Daiei was having a lot of financial troubles during this time. As a matter of fact, this film was not even released by Daiei. Another film company had to release the film due to Daiei's financial problems. As a matter of fact, Daiei did go out of business after releasing Gamera the Super Monster, or not Gamera the Super Monster, but Gamera versus Zigra. Right at the end of this film, it kind of went into bankruptcy. It did go into bankruptcy. And a lot of that was due to, from what I've read, mismanagement of funds, where, you know, there was kind of a little bit of shadiness going on, and mismanagement and money being ushered in over here when it should have been going into the studio and things of that nature. But the studio did go out of business shortly after this film. And this film, for Daiei, they had high hopes that it would bring in enough money to kind of, you know, put them back into the green. But unfortunately, that simply did not happen. I gotta tell you too, guys, that, you know, in terms of a production wise, miniatures, models, and all that, the film does suffer, guys. It's definitely, I mean, it's kind of sad that you can see the decline in visual effects and all that when these films came out. Just, you know, every film along the line just got more and more unimpressive. And this film is no exception, guys. As a matter of fact, they actually used a little bit of blue screen, but they also used rear projection, where, you know, they had a big screen up and they'd have characters standing in front of that screen. And of course, that's a way of saving money instead of using the blue screen process. But some of the rear projection stuff is really, really terrible. Some of the worst I've ever seen. As a matter of fact, it looked like the screen just had lines going straight down it. And when characters in front of that screen, you just see these terrible lines going down. It was just a sad state for the character to, or for the film series to end by, really. Just sad. Now, I really don't know what happened with this film. And by that I mean that, you know, AIP here in the U.S. had released all the Gamera films straight to television except for the original film. And this film, they did not even release on television. They chose not to acquire this movie. And I don't know why that is. From what I've read, I haven't been able to really look into it or find any information on it. But rumor has it that, you know, the previous film didn't do well for AIP, and that this film, they just, you know, didn't have any hopes for the studio. They knew that Daiei was having financial problems, and they just chose not to be a part of it. Anyway, that's the rumor, guys, but, you know, who knows? That may not have been true. AIP may have wanted to sink their money into other investments and just simply not do anything with the Gamera franchise at this point. As a matter of fact, this film is one of the least seen as far as the Gamera films are concerned here in the U.S., this and Gamera the Super Monster. As a matter of fact, this was not seen on American TVs until 1980, when Sandy Frank acquired the films, redubbed the films, and put them on television. You might wonder, guys, Sandy Frank, when I read that name, I kind of thought, that name sounds familiar. I remember seeing that somewhere. Well, on television, Sandy Frank was responsible for bringing Battle of the Planets, the anime show, to the U.S. on Saturday morning. And I remember that name because right when that show comes on, you see big words, Sandy Frank Presents or something like that. But yeah, that was Battle of the Planets, which I think in Japan, wasn't it called Gachi Man? I'm sure some fans will be able to let me know about that. But that's how I remember the name Sandy Frank. Now, one thing I got to give Daiei credit for, guys, is that They are pretty creative when it comes to the monsters. By that I mean they don't use traditional monster suits. They actually try to hide the fact that there's a human in a suit by making monsters that are just a little bit different and not so humanoid like a lot of the other monster companies would do. But Zigra is definitely a different type of monster, guys. It's almost like an alien shark, or at least an alien sea creature. As a matter of fact, the suit itself isn't just terribly bad or anything like that. I would say what really kind of bothered me about Zigra wasn't so much the story or anything like that. It's just the fact that it was just made so cheaply. And, you know, these monster films, we talk about the stories and how they're flimsy and weak lots of the time. Well, monster stories have never just really been, you know, just some of the greatest storytelling ever to begin with. Because by the end of the story, everybody just wants to see these monsters kick each other's ass. And this film is no exception. As a matter of fact, I will say, guys, that this film actually, while Gamera's fighting the creature, it's actually, there was a time when I was really, really rooting for Gamera to win. And I, you know, in a Godzilla film, I'm always kind of like, come on, you know, I want Godzilla to win. But in the Gamera films, I never really got that feeling where I just, you know, was rooting for Gamera and wanting Gamera to win. But that kind of struck me in this movie. And I don't know why it was this movie that struck me in, but it did. And it came to a point where I was just thinking, you know, to myself, come on, Gamera, you got to win. And I was really rooting for Gamera. And that was kind of a neat part of the film. I will say, guys, that, you know, we have an alien woman in this film who's just simply gorgeous, just a beautiful woman. These films, not only Gamera, but Godzilla, had some of the beautiful, most beautiful Japanese women in these films. And you know, it's this one is no exception. The lead character was really a very, very beautiful woman, an exotic woman with a very kind of outworldly, exotic appearance. So that was really really kind of nice to see in these films when the women are just so pretty. And once again, guys, you know, kids as actors, kids starring in the film, kids figuring out everything, and same basic Gamera formula in all these films. So, you know, Gamera shows up, fights the creature, you know, is taken out for a while, then he comes back and wins. But you know, guys, in all Gamera films, there's a lot of silliness, and this film is no exception. As a matter of fact, as far as the story goes, Zigra comes down from an alien planet, and his plan is to not only enslave the Earth, but use the people as basically cattle and feed on them. On Zigra's world, you know, instead of like on Earth, how people feed off the animals in the sea, in Zigra's world, people or creatures in the sea feed off the life on the surface on his planet. So he comes to Earth, and these two kids and their dads are out on the beach. Or no, they're not on the beach. They're actually on the water in a boat. He beams the entire boat with the father and the kids to his ship. They meet this alien girl, the really pretty alien girl. She snaps her finger. The parents go out in a coma. And then she gets distracted by something happening on the view screen, or leaves us the scene or something. And, you know, they put their dads back in the boat, and they figure, we're going to get out of here while she's gone. So they load the dads up. One of the kids gets in the boat, and he's like, well, how do we get out of here? And one kid says, just push the green button. And, you know, he pushes the green button, and they vanish. And I'm like, really? You push the green button? We've come millions of miles, and our ship is so technologically advanced that we just, you know to push a green button and we get off the ship. I mean, as far as that kid knows, he could have been launching a nuclear bomb or some kind of atom smasher or anything. But he pushes the green button and gets off the planet. So, or not off the planet, but he gets off the ship and he's beamed down to the surface of the Earth. So that worked. You know, the alien girl comes back, sees that they're gone. And Zigra, which is kind of a unique monster in that he can communicate telepathically. He's not just a dumb, snarling, growling monster. He actually communicates with this girl. And he says, capture those kids. They'll reveal our plan. Of course, the aliens have told their entire plan to the kids. So Zegra's like, capture these kids. Actually, no, he didn't say capture these kids. He said kill them. Kill these kids because they're going to reveal our plan. And I'm thinking, well, you know, even if they do reveal your plan, what are the humans going to do to stop you? So we have a whole subplot in the story where this girl's just running around. And of course she runs to SeaWorld so we can see what's going on at SeaWorld and all the attractions. We're seeing shots of the aquarium and all the animals on display and all that. And so she's chasing the kids around SeaWorld, you know, running commercial for everyone that hadn't been to SeaWorld in the film. In the audience, rather. And it's just like a whole useless side story that doesn't even need to happen. I mean, Zigra telling the alien girl to capture the kid or kill the kids is just totally, you know, just so they can show off the attractions at SeaWorld. And it's just kind of silly, guys, because it's just a totally unnecessary subplot in the story. But I will say, guys, that, you know, like the scene in Gamera versus, which film was it? I think it was Giron. No, it wasn't Giron. It was the one with the giant knife on his head. I can't remember his name right now. But in that film, there's a scene where, you know, I believe it's that film anyway, where Gamera does the gymnastics with the bar and just spins around and spins around on the bar. In this film, we have a scene where Gamera actually dances. He dances in the movie. So, you know, he's the friend of all children, and he's also the friend of disco. But he dances in the movie, guys, so that was kind of a fun scene. And there's actually a scene in the film, I'm talking about silly moments, where he's got Zigra down on the ground and he's playing his fin like a xylophone. So you know, you kind of see how far the films had kind of stooped to entertain its youthful audience. One of the disappointing aspects of the movie, guys, is the English dub of the film itself. Now, I believe what I'm listening to is the Sandy Frank dub. Now, there's usually, some of the films had two English dubs on them. One was the American International dub and AIP's dub of the film. But I believe this one maybe had Sandy Frank's dub of the film, since it had not been released here in the U.S. before Sandy Frank got a hold of the films and he had it redubbed. But the sound on the dubbing, the English version, the dubbing is actually pretty poor. You have to turn up the volume pretty high to actually hear the sound. It sounds muffled, and it's a bad dub all the way around, which is sad. You know, the dub is really bad, and the picture quality, like I said, is really bad too. So, you know, that's two really sucking aspects of the film. And another thing about the dub also, guys, is that, you know, in the previous films on the English dub, we have the characters calling Gamera, Gamera. In this film, they actually call him Gamera. The English characters say Gamera. So that's pretty interesting. And as far as Zigra being a thinking monster, it kind of communicates telepathically. Its strategies for beating Gamera is just silly. I mean, it holds some of the humans at bay, some of the kids, to use against Gamera. And it's just basically a retread, a poor retelling of previous Gamera films. And that's kind of a sad thing about it, guys. It's almost like Daiei was just kind of desperate in this film. They were just hitting all the wrong marks, so to speak. So it's a very disappointing film, guys. I got to say, I was disappointed with this film. And it would be one of my least favorites in the series so far. As a matter of fact, I've probably got to say that, from what I've heard of Gamera the Super Monster, that these two will probably be my least favorite films in the franchise. But anyway, guys, you know, once again, simplistic plot, guys. Alien come down, they want to take over the Earth, they want to feed on humans, and the only thing that stands in their way is Gamera. And the aliens have this unique ability to where they can just, you know, put humans to sleep. And it's up to the humans to crack the code and figure out how to awake these people. And actually, Gamera gets struck by the same beam where he just falls asleep. It's up to the humans to figure out how to snap not only their race out of it, but Gamera out of it as well. And as always, Gamera is the only hope between the humans and the alien. But anyway, if you're a Gamera fan, check it out, guys. If you're a giant monster fan, check it out. It's not the worst film in the franchise. It's just, by this time, it just seems like the whole film series, the whole franchise, is just tired. And it's just nothing new that they could put into it to make it appealing. Other than Zigra, which I think is kind of a cool monster. But he's just in a pretty bad film. They just could have done a lot better. Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. The next film in the original Gamera franchise, the final film, will be Gamera the Super Monster. And then we will visit the Gamera films of the 90s. Thanks for watching, everybody, and I will see you at the next video.